Good morning. So let us continue our next class on information theory and coding. We had stopped with linear block codes. We discussed various methods to construct linear block codes by adding redundancy to the data vector. And at the receiver side, we also understood how to detect and correct for errors. We also studied about the error detection and correction hardware. Many techniques were studied under linear block codes. Now we'll move on to the next part, that is cyclic codes. These cyclic codes are a subclass of linear block codes. Okay, so let's see what would be the outcomes. At the end of the subunit cyclic codes, a student would be able to understand how to determine the code word comprising of both check and data bits, both in systematic and non-systematic form using cyclic encoders. And he'll also be able to design encoding and decoding circuits for cyclic codes. And at the end of today's class, you would be able to understand the basic concept of cyclic codes and also determine a code word comprising of redundant or check bits along with data bits, both in non-systematic and systematic form. Coming to the basics of cyclic codes, the complete set of linear block codes is supposed to be very large. So one important subclass of linear block codes is known as the cyclic codes. And because they are characterized by the fact that any cyclic shift in the code word is also a code word, we consider this as a very important subclass of cyclic linear block codes. And it has a wide range of applications. Because of its applications, cyclic codes have found to be of great use even today. They are also used in different forms in cryptographic applications also. Coming to the first application, is about Hamming codes, which we have already studied. So cyclic codes could be used in Hamming codes. Then they could also be used in maximal length codes, which have very good autocorrelation properties. So they are very much correlate. There is lots of correlation between one code and the other. Because of that, we can design maximal length codes, and they are normally used for other applications other than just forward error correction, which we are trying to do here. Channel coding applications we are doing here, also known as error control coding. But maximal length codes are used for many other applications also. Then we have the CRC or the cyclic redundancy check codes, which are commonly used for data transmission and reception in the data link layer. So when we study computer networks, there we'll be studying a layered architecture. The second layer is known as data link layer, and that layer will add a CRC or cyclic redundancy check to every data byte, or let's say to every unit of data which goes through the network. And that code will be verified at the receiver. And if it matches, it will be recomputed. And if you get the same value as that was sent, then there is no error. That's how they decide whether there was an error in transmission or not. And other than that, we have additional classes of or improved versions of cyclic codes known as the BCH codes, the Bose-Chowdhury-Hockenham codes. It's a large family of cyclic codes. These offer flexibility in the choice of code parameters like block length, code rate, etc. They are also commonly used in many applications like in satellite communication and so on. And other than that, we have Reed-Solomon or RS codes, which are another subclass of non-binary BCH codes. The encoder for an RS code differs from binary encoder that in the fact that it operates on multiple bits rather than individual bits at a time. So this RS n comma k code always satisfies this one condition known as n minus k is equal to 2t, which makes RS codes very powerful in terms of error correction codes. So these Reed-Solomon codes are also commonly used in lots of communication systems like radar and satellite today. Okay, I told you they're also commonly used in cryptographic applications. Now, coming to understanding what are cyclic codes. Cyclic codes are, as I told you, such codes, cyclic shifts of those codes will result in another code word which will belong to the same set of codes. Say I have a set of codes known as C. Okay, so if there is a, let me connect this. Yeah, say I have one code C1, which is 1011011. This belongs to the actual code C, a major code. Now, if I rotate this cyclically, say I perform one cyclic shift operation, I'm taking a right shift here. That means this LSB comes to the MSB position and each bit here shifts right. So 1011011. This has gone here. This would be another code word C2, which also belongs to C. Similarly, if I perform another cyclic rotation of this, I'm going to get the rightmost bit will come to the leftmost position. So 1110110. This will result in another code word, say C6, which also belongs to the same set of codes C. So what is the basic meaning of cyclic codes? The basic meaning of cyclic codes is that cyclic rotations or shifts, bitwise cyclic rotations or shifts in a given code word will result in another code word, which also belongs to the same code, same master code or the same code set. This property is known as cyclic property. You can understand the cyclic property from this diagram, the circular diagram which is shown below. You see here V0, V1, V2, V3, they all represent binary ones and zeros, bits. Okay, and let me say first code A, CA is written in the form V0, V1, V2, so on till Vn minus 1. Now, if I do one bit shift, code B can be referring. So I'll do a shift like this. Code B will start with Vn minus 1, V0, V1, so on. So it ends with Vn minus 2. Okay, you can see here code B is starting at this point with Vn minus 1. Now, another left shift I'll do, code C. After shifting left again, it will start with Vn minus 2, Vn minus 1, V0, V1, so on, Vn minus 3. So likewise, I can go on cyclically rotating the particular bits in one code word, and you will be getting codes which also belong to the same set of codes or the same master code. This property is known as cyclic property. You can see rotating it in the form of a cycle wheel or something, you will be getting code words which belong to the same set of codes. Okay. So what is the main use of these cyclic codes? Cyclic codes are attractive for two main reasons. The first reason is that encoding and syndrome calculations can be easily implemented using simple shift registers with feedback connections. We call them as linear feedback shift registers. So we are going to use simple shift registers and give some feedback connections for implementing the hardware of cyclic codes. Encoders and decoders in cyclic codes can be done very easily using LFSRs, linear feedback shift registers, we call them as, in short, LFSR. These are very, very useful for many more applications. And the second important reason why cyclic codes are popular, they possess a very well-defined mathematical structure. So these cyclic codes have a very, very well-defined mathematical structure. They can be, we can use polynomial algebra to analyze them, okay? And this mathematical structure permits the design of higher order error correcting codes easily. Like I told you about the BCH, Bose-Chowdhury-Hockingham code, RS code, they are higher order versions of the cyclic code. So we can design many higher order versions of the cyclic codes using these basic cyclic codes, mainly because of their very good algebraic or mathematical structure. So we are going to use polynomial algebra in analyzing cyclic codes, which turns out to be quite interesting. Okay. And a binary code, which is cyclic, normally satisfies two properties. The first one is linearity property. We have already seen what is linearity property in linear block codes also. The sum of two code vectors or two code words should also be another code word which belongs to the code. So if C1 belongs to C and C2 also belongs to C, then C1 plus C2 should also result in some value, say CX, which belongs to C. Okay, this is known as the linearity property. The cyclic property is any lateral shift of a code word is also a code word. I told you, cyclic shift or lateral shift means one and the same. A bitwise shift either to the right or left, okay, is known as cyclic rotation or cyclic property. Now, after understanding what are cyclic codes, let's try to get an insight into its mathematical structure. We said its mathematical structure is so good that we can use polynomial algebra for analysis. So, in order to get into the mathematical structure, let us try to consider a code vector or an n-tuple read from A in the clockwise direction in figure 1. So, in this figure, starting from A, we are going to read this code vector in the clockwise direction. So it will be V0, V1, V2, V3, so on till Vn minus 1, right? It ends with Vn minus 1 when we start with V0. So this is a code vector. Similarly, if I try to read the code vector B starting from this is position for B in the clockwise direction, you notice I'll get Vn minus 1 as the first bit. Then it is V0, V1, V2, so on, and it ends with Vn minus 2, as you can see here. Okay, this is also a code vector belonging to the same cyclic code. In this way, we can list all the code vectors or n-tuples which are obtained using successive cyclic right shifts. So what we are doing next, on similar terms, I can write V2 as Vn minus 2. See, V2 starts here, the code vector C, okay? Vn minus 2, Vn minus 1, so on. It ends with Vn minus 3. V3, likewise, Vn minus 3, it will start and end with Vn minus 4. So if you notice, we can generalize all this for any particular code vector Vi as Vn minus I, Vn minus I plus 1, you see, based on the same logic. V3 is Vn minus 3, Vn minus 2. So Vi is Vn minus I, Vn minus I plus 1. So on, V0, V1 we'll get. And the last one should be Vn minus I minus 1. So for V3, I have the last one as Vn minus 4. For V2, Vn minus 3. Just like that, for Vi, we should have Vn minus I minus 1. Okay. All these are code vectors belonging to the same cyclic code. And this property of cyclic codes enables us to treat elements of each code vector as coefficients of a polynomial of degree n minus 1. Okay, because of this cyclic rotation property, we can work with polynomial algebra where all these coefficients, the v values, they are considered as the binary coefficients, and they can be considered as coefficients of a polynomial function in any variable x. Okay, and the degree of that polynomial would be n minus 1. So this is the property which is extremely useful in analysis and implementation of the cyclic codes. So how do we represent the code polynomial v of x? For a cyclic code, you just observe this. V of x is normally written. I told you we are going to write it in the form of polynomials, where all the v values will act like coefficients of the variable x. So let me consider this first representation v. Okay. So considering v naught as the first bit, it will be v naught here into 1. 1 means x power 0. Okay. This is v naught into 1. So v naught into x power 0. Next is the second bit is v1. V1 into x power 1. V2 into x square plus v3 into x cubed. So on. We can continue this till vn minus 1 into x to the power of n minus 1. So this equation is very, very important. It gives us the standard algebraic representation or polynomial representation of any given code vector in cyclic codes. Okay. So we used to call the code vector by the name C in linear block codes. Here we are calling it by a different name, V. Anyway, nothing is there in the name. You just have to understand how it functions. So continuing this analysis, our mathematical analysis of cyclic codes, we see here the code vector is given by this equation, which I told you is very important for you to remember. Okay. And notice that the coefficients of the polynomial are either 0 or 1. Surely they are binary values, and hence they belong to GF2, Galois field 2. So what do you mean by Galois field 2? I'll have only two values there, zeros and ones, and I can normally perform two operations, addition and multiplication. So it is like addition of binary numbers and multiplication of binary numbers. Whatever result you're going to get with zeros and ones, the same thing is applicable here. Okay. So we are working in binary codes in GF2. Each power of x in V of x represent a 1-bit cyclic shift in time. Yes. Every time I have a given function and I multiply it with x again, it will represent a right cyclic shift in time. Okay. So multiplication of v of x by x may be viewed as a cyclic shift or rotation to the right. So every time I multiply with x a given code polynomial, we are going to cyclically rotate it to the right once when I multiply it with x. Say I multiply it with x square, then I'm going to cyclically rotate it to the right twice, x into x, okay, two rotations to the right. Likewise, this is subject to the condition that x power n is equal to 1. Okay. And this condition helps us in restoring x into v of x to the degree n minus 1. I don't want to exceed beyond the degree n minus 1. So the highest degree of the polynomial should be n minus 1. So this will help us restore that x into v of x to degree n minus 1. And it also implies that rightmost bit is fed back to the left. So I showed you in the previous how the rightmost bit which was there here becomes the leftmost bit in the next. The rightmost bit here becomes leftmost bit in the next cyclically shifted version. Okay. So that's what this means. This special form of multiplication is known as multiplication mod x bar n plus 1. Okay. So this polynomial multiplication which we are doing is called multiplication modulo x bar n plus 1. Therefore, for a single shift, we are going to have x into v of x is equal to what? V naught into x. Here, you take this equation 4, which we have here, the upper one, and multiply it with x. So you're going to have x into v of x on the left hand side. Then on the right hand side, v naught into x plus v1 into x square plus v2 into x cube, so on. And the last digit would be plus vn minus 1 into x bar n, right? So now to this equation, I will simply add vn minus 1 plus vn minus 1. Remember, addition of this term should not make any change because remember a plus a is a 0 in modulo 2 arithmetic. So if I just add vn plus vn minus 1 plus vn minus 1, that means I'm adding a 0 to the existing value. Okay. This will help us in simplifying this equation. I'll take one vn minus 1 to the left side and another vn minus 1 to the end. So you'll get the beginning as vn minus 1 plus v naught x plus v1 x square, so on. And the last term here, I have vn minus 1 into x bar 1 plus vn minus 1 if I do, I'll get vn minus 1 into x bar n plus 1. Combining this with this, combining these two, we will be getting this equation. Okay. This I can say is equivalent to v1 of x, which is the remainder obtained by dividing what? X v of x with x bar n plus 1. Why should I divide this? Because we are doing multiplication mod x bar n plus 1. So this is our limiting value. We are trying to calculate the multiplication x into v of x, and after multiplying, I should do mod x bar n plus 1. This is the highest value which is allowed. So after multiplying, when I do mod x bar n plus 1, it is like taking the product and dividing it with x bar n plus 1. And whatever remainder I'm going to get, that remainder is the answer for x into v of x mod x bar n plus 1. And we are calling this as v1 of x. Okay. Now, coming to the complete mathematical structure, it turns out that v1 of x can be written as we saw, vn minus 1. So what is v1 of x here? Vn minus 1 remains plus v0 x plus v1 x square, so on. And the last term that will be left will be vn minus 2 here. This one, vn minus 2 into x to the power of n minus 1. And this term, whenever I have divided, that term will get eliminated. So you see, the equation 5 contains only till vn minus 2 bit to the power of xn minus 1. So this order of the polynomial remains always as x bar n minus 1. And this represents the code polynomial for v of 1. And we can go on continuing this till we get a general format. That general format can be written as x bar I v of x is v bar, or let's say vi of x plus q of x into x bar n plus 1. See, whenever we do a modulo arithmetic, like something like this, v of x mod x bar n plus 1, or x into v of x mod x bar n plus 1, something like this, what you will always get a quotient and a remainder, right? So how do I express the complete here? What is the divisor? See, in x v of x, the divisor is x bar n plus 1. So how will we write the divisibility equation? quotient into divisor plus remainder. That's all we are doing. We are writing quotient into divisor here, and the remainder of this solution is vi of x. So this is q into x power n plus 1 plus vi of x. Okay, so this is how we write the standard form of, for anything in the form xi into v of x, x power I into v of x, can be written like this: quotient into divisor plus remainder. Okay, where, how do you define this vi of x? It is vn minus I, we are standardizing this, plus vn minus I plus 1 into x, because it becomes v naught. So on this goes, and you see the powers of x are increasing. Okay, so I will have v naught into x power I minus 1, v1 into x power I plus 1, so on. And it ends at vn minus I minus 1. So if we have v1, it ends at vn minus 2. So if I have vi, it should end at vn minus I minus 1. And the highest power will always be x to the power of n minus 1. Okay, so this is the standard representation of any cyclic code vector. Now, the coefficients of the polynomial function v naught to vn minus 1, I told you, belong to the binary field or GF2. So they belong to GF of 2, and the following rules of addition and multiplication can be obtained. We are familiar with this. 0 plus 0 is a 0. 0 plus 1, 1 plus 0 is a 1, and 1 plus 1 turns out to be a 0 in modulo 2 arithmetic. This is one very useful rule for us, right? We are often using this rule. Similarly, in multiplication, 0 into 0 is 0, 0 into 1 is 0, 1 into 0 will also give you a 0, and 1 into 1 will give you a 1. So this set of coefficients, along with their respective operations, are known as GF2, Galois field 2. So Galois field 2 will include what? The elements 1s and 0s, along with the set of operations, addition and multiplication. Okay. Now, with all these basics, let us see how to generate a cyclic code, starting with something known as a generator polynomial. So it's a very, very useful polynomial in generating cyclic codes. An n, k cyclic code will be specified by complete set of code polynomials of degree less than or equal to n minus 1. We said the maximum degree should be n minus 1. And it contains a generator polynomial of degree n minus k as a factor, which is known as the generator polynomial. So the order or the degree of g of x is n minus k. Please remember this. It will be useful in solving problems. Okay. So this generator polynomial can generate the complete set of code vectors which belongs to a given cyclic code. So the polynomial known as generator polynomial is equivalent to the generator matrix which we have used in our block codes. Also, it is the only polynomial of lowest degree, n minus k, and it is surely unique. We won't have two generators. A given circuit will normally have a single generator. So, based on this, we have an important theorem, which is stated as follows. If g of x is a polynomial of degree n minus k, and it is a factor of the primitive polynomial, this x power n plus 1, we call it as the primitive polynomial x power n plus 1, then g of x generates an n, k cyclic code in which the code polynomial v of x for a data vector u, like I'm calling this data vector can be d or u, d naught, d1, so on, dk minus 1. Or we could directly write it as d1, d2 till dk. Anything we can use, either this or u. The representation I told you can be anything. So the code vector is obtained as the data vector d of x into the generator polynomial g of x. Therefore, the data vector d of x, which is defined as what? So if you want to write it as d of x, you should write it as d naught plus d1 into x plus d2 into x square plus dk minus 1 into x power k minus 1. Okay, so this represents the data polynomial, and the highest degree of this data polynomial is k minus 1. Now, we have described the cyclic codes with right shift operation till now, but we can also describe cyclic codes with left shift operations by simply rewriting the polynomials as follows. So if I want to do a left shift operation, I'll write the data vector as u naught into x power k minus 1, u1 into x power k minus 2, so on, uk minus 2 into x plus uk minus 1 is the final data bit. So here, the code vector or the code polynomial v of x is defined in the general format v naught x power n minus 1, v1 x power n minus 2, and it ends with vn minus 1. Okay. And finally, we have the generator polynomial g of x, which is also defined as g naught into which is also defined as g naught x power n minus k, g1 x to the power of n minus k minus 1, so on till gn minus k. The highest degree of the generator is supposed to be how much? The highest degree of the generator is n minus k. Okay, now we can represent all this put together in this standard form for left shift operations as x n minus k plus summation I is equal to 1 to n minus k gi into x power n minus k minus I plus gn minus k. Anyway, normally we prefer doing right shift operations. This is only for those applications when you want to do left shift operations. The rest of the manipulations and procedures will be the same for both. Okay. Now, let's come to some properties of the generator polynomial for cyclic codes. So, the generator polynomial has to have some very important properties for cyclic codes. The first property is there exists a generator polynomial of degree n minus k, which generates a cyclic code, which is represented as g naught plus g1x plus g2x square plus g3x cubed, so on, gn minus k x to the power of n minus k, right? This is what we discussed in the last slide also. So every cyclic code will have a generator polynomial of degree n minus k, which will help us generate in the cyclic code. This generator polynomial is a unique polynomial since it is the only polynomial of minimum degree n minus k. Out of all the code polynomials which exist in cyclic codes, the generator will turn out to be the only polynomial of degree n minus k. Okay. And the generator polynomial of an n comma k cyclic code is always a factor of the primitive polynomial x power n plus 1, which means to say that if I divide x power n plus 1 with the generator g of x, I'm going to generate a quotient plus the remainder. That remainder would be zero. And the quotient which we generate is known as the parity check polynomial h of x. Remember, we have studied the parity check matrix in linear block codes. Similar to that, the concept of parity check polynomial comes in cyclic codes. Remember, in cyclic codes, we are talking about polynomials rather than matrices. We will talk about matrices also a little later, but polynomials are more of interest in cyclic codes. So just like how we spoke of generator polynomial in the first point, the parity check polynomial h of x is another factor of the primitive polynomial x power n plus 1. Also, if g of x is a polynomial of degree n minus k and it is a factor of the primitive polynomial x power n plus 1, then it generates a cyclic code. Please remember, when g of x is a polynomial of degree n minus k, that is compulsory. And it should also be a factor of the primitive polynomial x power n plus 1. In the sense, it should divide x power n plus 1 without leaving any remainder. It should result in the parity check polynomial h of x, the quotient value. Okay? And where h of x represents the parity check polynomial. Now, coming to the last two properties, which tell us two different methods of generating cyclic codes. Or how to do cyclic encoding. The first method will give us the cyclic code in the non-systematic format. I hope all of you remember what is non-systematic format. Non-systematic format means that the data bits and the code bits, or let's say the data bits and the check bits, are interleaved and they cannot be separated. You can't have a clear distinction between what is data and which are the check bits in a given code word. Then we say that code word is in non-systematic format. Okay. So here, if I have to find a cyclic code word in non-systematic form, I can simply use a very simple relation. The code vector v of x is the data vector d of x into the generator polynomial g of x. Remember, they have also called this data polynomial as u of x generator. Both are same, whether you want to call it as d or g or u, whatever. Sorry, g is for generator. For data, you can call d or u. For code polynomial, c or v. Okay? Where this data polynomial is represented as d0 plus d1 into x plus d2 x square, so on. Remember, I have only k bits in the data. So it will be dk minus 1 into x power k minus 1. So this is a k bit data polynomial represented like this. So this equation gives us a very easy way of finding the cyclic code vector in non-systematic format, where the check bits and data bits cannot be separated out. Lastly, the technique to obtain the cyclic code in systematic form. If I want to get the cyclic code in systematic form, we can do it by using this method. You multiply x power n minus k. Okay, x power n minus k should be multiplied with data polynomial d of x and then divide it with generator polynomial g of x, and whatever remainder I get after this division, that remainder should be appended. This remainder it's got converted into a pointer. This remainder should be appended to the data polynomial in the beginning. So normally we always append these the remainder polynomial constitutes the check bits, or we call them as parity bits. They are the additional bits which are used for error detection and correction. Okay. So these extra bits which are present as coefficients of the remainder polynomial, after dividing x power n minus k into d of x with g of x, are appended to the data polynomial in the beginning. Okay. Hence, this format is another way of obtaining the cyclic code in the systematic form. So we can obtain the cyclic code in both systematic and non-systematic forms. Before we move on to the actual computation with cyclic codes, let us try to analyze some polynomial arithmetic. So let's work with say polynomial addition first. So if we want to add, say for example, here x plus x will give you a 0. Please remember. Similarly, if I have x cubed plus x cubed, this is also x cubed into 1 plus 1. Remember, in binary addition, we said 1 plus 1 is a 0, right? So the same condition we are trying to use here. So just like x plus x being 0, x square plus x square, x cube plus x cube, everything will turn out to be a 0. Otherwise, any two polynomials is normal addition. Say 1 plus x cube, you add it to x square plus x to the power of 4. I have two polynomials. If I'm just adding them directly, I just have to simply add the terms. There is only one term with value 1. 1 means 1 into x to the power of 0. Is there any term with x? I have one term with x here and one term with x here. So x plus x results in a 0, right? Then x square term is there, x square, x cube term is there. I'm writing it in the ascending order. Then x power 4 term is there. So when I add these two polynomials, I will get it, get the result as 1 plus x square plus x cube plus x power 4. So it is simple addition of two polynomials in algebra. Okay. Now coming to the subtraction operation. This subtraction operation is very much similar to addition. So there is no much difference between subtraction and addition. Remember, here 0 minus 0 is a 0, 0 minus 1 is a 1, 1 minus 0 is also 1, 1 minus 1 is a 0. So am I getting the same answers which I got for addition? 0 plus 0, I got it as 0, 0 plus 1, we got it as 1, 1 plus 0, we got it as 1, and 1 plus 1, we are getting as 0. So if you remember, whether I do addition or subtraction, it is same in terms of binary arithmetic or modulo 2 arithmetic. Whenever we are working in Galois field 2 and we are doing modulo 2 arithmetic or modulo 2 addition, subtraction is similar to addition. Okay. So please keep in mind this fact. So if I have 1 plus x cubed minus x plus x square or so, this would result in the value x and x cancels, 1 plus x square plus x cubed. So I don't bother about this negative sign. Minus or plus means the same in modulo 2 arithmetic. I hope you are getting it. Next, coming to multiplication. Say, for example, let us consider 1 plus x cubed multiplied with 1 plus x. How do we perform multiplication? As usual, I'll take just one value and multiply. So 1 plus 1 into 1 is 1, 1 into x is x, plus 1 into x cubed is x cubed. I got the first row, let me say. Next, I'll take x and multiply it with 1, which will result in x. X into 1 is x, plus x into x gives you x square, plus x into x cubed gives you x to the power of 4. Now, we have completed the multiplication. We just have to add up the sub products. The intermediate products have to be added. So whenever there are even number of terms which are the same, they cancel out to give you a zero. But here x square, if you want, you can leave place for x square and then shift x cubed. So x square term is alone, x cube is there, x to the power of 4. Therefore, the result of multiplication of 1 plus x cubed into 1 plus x will be something like this. Okay. Likewise, you can try multiplying many different polynomials. Say x plus x cubed plus x power 7 into x square plus 1. All kinds of multiplication can be done. I want you to continue trying this at home. Now, let's try to do division. Division is performed in the standard way of how we learn division in our elementary school. Say, for example, I want to divide x power 7 plus 1 with x cubed plus x plus 1. So I am performing division of x power 7 plus 1 with x cubed plus x plus 1. You may wonder why we wrote it the other way around. Usually we used to write it as 1 plus x cubed. Here we've written it as x cubed plus x plus 1 because here we are performing a division operation where the highest degree term should be dealt with first. Yes or no? Now, the first quotient term will include, I need, what should I multiply x cubed with to get x power 7? I multiply with x power 4, which when I multiply this whole divisor with x power 4, I'm going to get x power 7 plus x power 5, x power 1 into x power 4 plus x power 4, which means here I told you whether it is a subtraction or addition, it means one and the same. Okay. So x power 7 plus x power 7 cancels. What is left is x power 5 plus x power 4 plus 1. This one also comes down. Now, again, looking into the divisor, it is two orders of magnitude less than x power 5. So I'll multiply it with x square now. So when you multiply this divisor with x square, what would you get? X power 5 plus x cubed plus x square. So this x power 5 cancels out. What is left out would be x power 4 plus x power 3 plus x square plus 1. Right? Now, this is still lesser. The highest powers you should compare. You'll keep doing the division till the value here is less than the highest power here. Now I can multiply it with x to get x power 4 plus x into x will give you x square plus x into 1 will give you x. So what do I get now? This cancels out. X cubed, x square term also cancels out. I have plus x plus 1. Now, if you observe, both are exactly the same. So I'll take 1 as the quotient. 1 into this will give me x cubed plus x plus 1, which gives you 0 as the remainder. So we are done with our division. So our traditional division method we are using. Okay. So what is the quotient here? The quotient is x power 4 plus x square plus x plus 1. I hope you understood how division is done in polynomial algebra. Okay, we have studied various different operations in polynomial algebra. Now, let us try to take some examples and find the code vectors, the cyclic code vectors for the given data vectors in both systematic and non-systematic form. So how do we go about this? Let's take this example, the first example, find the code vector for data vector 1101. So here D is given as 1101 in matrix form. Therefore, how do I write D of X? D of X, the first bit, leftmost bit is 1 into X bar 0. The next bit, the coefficient 1 into X bar 1. The third bit is a 0. We are moving from left to right. 0 into X square plus fourth bit is 1 into X cubed. You need not write such expanded equations always. Just to help you understand how it is done, I have written for the first time. Therefore, how do we write D of X? D of X is 1 plus X cubed. According to the given data, the corresponding polynomial, as you can see here, X bar 0 is 1. So 1 plus X, 1 into X, plus 0 plus 1 into X cubed, which gives me this value. Okay. Now, the generator matrix is given as 1 plus X cubed. And G of X is also 1 plus X cubed. Therefore, first, let's find in non-systematic format. What was the equation for finding code vector in non-systematic form? We know that V of X, the code vector, is nothing but D of X into G of X. Simple multiplication of the data polynomial with the generator polynomial. Therefore, V of X is obtained as 1 plus X cubed into the generator polynomial 1 plus X cubed. So here, since both are same, you can also take it as a square, or normal multiplication will be easier. I'll take the first term and multiply. I'm going to get 1 plus X cubed. Then the second term, when I multiply, I'm going to get plus X into 1 will be X, X into X will be X square, plus X into X cubed will be X bar 4. Next, the third term is X cubed. X cubed into 1 would give you X cubed. X cubed into X will give you X bar 4. X cubed into X cubed will give you X bar 6. Now I just have to add all these. This becomes 1. I have a single term 1, so it is retained. X is there twice. So X cancels. X square is there only once, so it should be retained. X cube is there twice, cancel. X bar 4 is there twice. X bar 6 is there only once. So the corresponding code vector or the code polynomial is V of X. Now, the corresponding code vector is by extracting the coefficients here. So what is the coefficient of X bar 0? It is 1. Coefficient of X bar 1 is not there. X bar 2 term is there, 1. X cube term is not there, 0. X to the power of 4 term is not there, 0. X bar 5 term is not there, 0. And X bar 6 term is there, 1. So this completes our coefficient representation, or the representation of the code word, the cyclic code word, in the form of a binary code vector. You see, I'm getting a 7-bit vector here. We have said it is a 7,4 code. So even if it stops earlier, I have to add zeros. Please remember, I have to get a 7-bit code word. Is this clear? So this is about how to obtain the code vector in non-systematic form. Likewise, for the same thing, let us do systematic form. To obtain V of X or V in systematic form, how are we going to do it in systematic form? Here, we are given D of X as 1 plus X cubed, and G of X is also 1 plus X cubed. Now, what should I do for systematic form. I have to find x to the power of n minus k and multiply this with the data polynomial and then divide it with the generator polynomial. So I know I have to compute this and find the remainder of this division, and that remainder we are going to take it and append it with the data in the beginning to get cyclic code vector in systematic form. So let us compute this. How much is x power n minus k? It is x power 7 minus 4, which is x cubed. D of x is 1 plus x cubed divided by g of x is 1 plus x cubed. Now, if I multiply this, this becomes x cubed plus x power 4 plus x power 6 divided by 1 plus x cubed. Now, let's do the division. I have computed this. Whenever I do division, I always write it from the highest power first. X power 4, x cubed. This should be divided by the same long division method. X cubed plus x plus 1. Now, I have x cubed as the first term here, x power 6. So, the first term in the quotient will be x cubed. So, when I multiply this whole divisor with x cubed, I'm going to get x power 6 plus x power 4 plus x cubed. So I directly got this value, x power 6 plus x power 4 plus x cubed, which results in 0, which means the quotient here is there and the remainder is 0. Therefore, you say r of x is 0. There is no remainder. Therefore, what is the code vector? The code vector v will be r appended with data. What was there in the data? The data value was 1 into x power 0, 1 into x power 1, 0 into x square, 1 into x cube. The 4-bit data vector was this. You see, that was the value given here, 1101. Okay. And the remainder bits now are 0. So I'll just append 3 remainder bits because I know the total length of the code vector should be 7 bits, right? Therefore, this represents the code vector V in systematic format. And if you want to write the code polynomial, it is just the remainder polynomial plus the data polynomial, which will be same as data polynomial here, which is shifted by that many parameters. It should be shifted to the right 3 times. Okay. So this is how we are going to write it. Okay. I hope you understood how it is done. We'll take another one example, maybe this one. Okay. There are 3 values given. Let's just take one example and do both systematic and non-systematic and stop for now. So first, non-systematic. Now we are familiar. Data is given as 1100, which represents 1 plus x in the polynomial form. And g of x is given as 1 plus x cubed. And it is a 7,4 code. Therefore, v of x is given as what? D of x into g of x, which is 1 plus x into 1 plus x cubed. So you do the normal multiplication. I think we had done it just now. 1 into this, 1 plus x cubed. And in the next row, x into 1 is x. Plus x into x is x squared. Plus x into x cubed is x power 4. So this results in 1 plus, this cancels out. x square plus x cube plus x bar 4. This is your code polynomial for the given cyclic code, and the code vector is only a coefficient vector extracted from this polynomial. X bar, starting with x bar 0 term in the left side, x bar 0 term is 1, x term is 0, x square term is 1, x cube term is there, coefficient is there, x bar 4 is there. Should I leave it here or continue? Remember, I should have a 7-bit code word. So I have to continue with zeros until I get 7 bits in the code word. Hence, this V represents the code word in non-systematic format. Now, the same thing, if we want to do it in systematic format for 1100, which is 1 plus x in a polynomial form, I know for systematic form, what should I do? In systematic form, I should take x to the power of n minus k, multiply it with the data polynomial, divide it with the generator. X power n minus k is x cubed. The data polynomial is 1 plus x, and divide it with 1 plus x cubed. So let me multiply this. I'll get x cubed plus x to the power of 4, right, in the numerator, and divide it with 1 plus x cubed. Now let's do the traditional long division. I'll write x power 4 first and then x cubed, divided with x cubed plus x plus 1. The quotient will be x. So x into x cubed will be x power 4. X into x is x square plus x. What would you get? This cancels. X cubed and x square plus x remains. Now I can take the quotient as plus 1. Now if I multiply this with 1, I'm going to get x cubed plus x plus 1. Again, x cubed cancels, x cancels. What remains is x square plus 1. So this is your remainder polynomial, x square plus 1. Now, to get the code vector in systematic form, I'll represent this remainder polynomial as a vector. That means it should be a 3-bit vector. And remember, when I'm representing as a vector, I should start with 1. X power 0 term is there, x term is not there, x square term is there. So this becomes 101. So I'll have 101 in the beginning and appended to in the beginning of the data 1100. So this represents the cyclic code in systematic form for the given code vector. I think with this basic, we can stop for today. We'll continue. I just want you to think about, if I want you to find the complete set of cyclic code vectors for all data possible with 4 bits. Imagine I'll have 2 power 4, 16 combinations. Do you sit and compute this throughout, or should there be some other easy way of doing it? Please think about it before you come to the next class or before you watch the next video. Thank you.